Okay, thank you. I'll say in advance that, as was just mentioned, I've been in this trying to manage water quality in the Great Barrier Reef for a very long time. We won't even talk about that, how long that was. And the talk I'm going to give today is, where are we up to now? And as you'll see from the title, we're not succeeding. And what could we do to actually succeed in managing water quality for the Great Barrier Reef? I'm the sole author on this talk, that obviously relies on the work of a huge number of other people. However, what I'm going to talk about is quite sensitive at the moment, and so I'm not putting anybody else's name on there so they get into trouble, particularly because right at this moment we're finalising the scientific consensus statement on water quality in the Great Barrier Reef, and it will overlap a little bit with what I'm going to say today, but not exactly. And so today is my take on what's going on alone. So I'm going to talk about the current state of the Great Barrier Reef briefly, the water quality issue itself and what the effects on the Great Barrier Reef are of water quality pollution, how we got to management, the plan itself, called reef plan generally, how the results of that work are going in reducing pollutant loads and how they're not going, I guess, and what can we do to improve that management. And I'll try and bring it back a bit to what's been talked about at this meeting already a bit. We really have to have reduced aims of management now. We're not going to restore the Great Barrier Reef to some condition like it was a decade or two ago. So we're thinking about that in water quality as well. How can we reduce our aims and still do something useful? The state of the Great Barrier Reef, I won't go through this in detail, but coral cover's declining pretty rapidly, as you all know. Who knows what it is at the moment? It was unpleasant to think about, really. Even in Torres Strait, where we had some of the best coral, where I work as well, is now in terrible shape, the coral cover. Dugong populations are really reduced in most of the Great Barrier Reef, and in fact the only place where there's really great dugong populations is in Torres Strait, outside the park and the World Heritage Area. Seagrass in decline generally, but with a great, as Alana talked about, great possibility of recovery there. We've got crown of thorns starfish again, the fourth wave's coming down from Cairns to Townsville as we speak here. In more coral disease, declining coral calcification, and now of course we've seen the bleaching that's been talked about. Water quality, what's it about? Well, really it's simple. You've heard me, many of you heard me say this before. Loads of things like sediment, nutrients and pesticides have increased greatly by discharge, mainly from agriculture, also from urban and other sources, and particularly in the southern two-thirds of the Great Barrier Reef, Cape York, far less increase in the amount of sediment, nutrients and pesticides entering the Great Barrier Reef. What do these do? Well, the sediment comes from things like those big gullies you can see there on the right up in the Normandy catchment, that one, from photos from Andrew Brooks, who works up there, and of course they come out in these big flood plumes, one shown from the Burdekin there. Sediment, increased turbidity, lack of light for seagrass, coral, and the subsequent effects, like seagrass in Cleveland Bay disappeared altogether a few years ago, but has now come back, and due to the sediment discharge from the Burdekin River. Sedimentation of organic-rich sediments does nasty things to corals, and we find suspended sediment from the work of Amelia Wenger that most of you will know of has a lot of effects on juvenile coral reef fish. And from the work of David Bellwood's group, we know that fine suspended sediment in turf algae has quite large effects on the ability and desire, I suppose, of grazing fish to actually eat the turf algae. Nutrients, a whole range of effects of nutrients. I'm talking more about sediments and nutrients today, not pesticides, by the way. Crown of thorns starfish, increased presence of macroalgae, sensitivity of coral to bleaching. There's still a very active research area about how that works. Increased bioerosion from nutrients. It's not just sediments that cause coastal turbidity, it's interaction of nutrients and sediment together. And there's links to coral disease in poor water quality as well. So the whole range of effects that we're worried about that are actually taking place, the ones that, why we want to manage water quality. Right, well, we started this a long time ago with research in the 1980s and 1990s, a lot of research. And by about 2001, we had enough research to develop a plan. It was called the Water Quality Action Plan all that time ago. And that plan led to our actual water quality plan for the Great Barrier Reef, Reef Plan, in 2003. So that's now 14 years ago. It's been updated since. Was finally funded. Unfortunately, took a while to fund, and so it wasn't really funded until 2008 with the change of government. And there was some funding, not enough really even then, but substantial funding. And so we've only really been spending money on water quality management since 2008, so 9 years really. It's not a long time. And in fact, I'm going to say later, that was too little too late really to have any major effect. We spent about $400 million in the first 5 years, and now in the last few years we've spent another couple of hundred million on water quality management. And what we have now also that Terry Hughes talked about is a new plan for the whole of the Great Barrier Reef called the Reef 2050 Plan, which has a water quality element. Terry mentions it doesn't got many other elements. It doesn't address climate change, for instance. It does address water quality in a pretty poor way. The wording of it's quite, for water quality, is quite terrible, really. But at least it's in there. And we hope that it's being implemented and that we're actually managing water quality. However, the report that came out last year, which reported up to 2015, and I'll show you the results in a moment, on water quality management and reduction of loads showed minimal progress. We're not really making much progress. You can see some of the numbers here. I'll show you a graph of this as well. The target for reducing dissolved inorganic nitrogen was meant to be 50% reduction by 2018. We achieved 18% reduction by 2015, and the score, the report card, this is the official government report card, scored at E. That's A, B, C, D, E, that's the bad end. Sediments, a bit better, got a C. And the land management scores were their targets as well, where we expected to get 90% of sugarcane farmers to best management practice, scored a D. You can see we only got 23%. And the same for grazing, quite a poor score. It actually, where we look at the management up the catchment of the Great Barrier Reef, so not a great result. And this is after spending close to $500 million. So it's a lot of money we spent on this, and we're not doing too well. This is the graphs that were in that report last year showing progress towards the targets. And you can see they... There is some progress up to about here for most of them. They're not getting near the targets, which I'll put on the right for clarity. And after 2013, in the last few years, it's plateauing off as well. Progress has slowed as well. And we can measure this rate of decline. We're still spending the same sort of money, but we're not even having as much effect as we did years ago. That's because we're getting into harder sorts of management as well. We can project forward our progress to 2025, which is the target area now in the Reef 2050 plan, and this was done by the Queensland Government's Great Barrier Reef Water Science Task Force in this diagram, which from that report last year. And I'll just, there's a red words there that say time lags modelled out. That's really important as well. This is progress as if all the works in the catchment had actually taken effect immediately. that doesn't work like that. Can you imagine you're planting trees on a stream bank? They don't immediately turn into 30-metre trees. Takes a few years, maybe 15 years. So we model that out. We assume that everything we do on the catchment in a management sense has instant effects at the end of the river. We have to do that for various reasons, to show that we're actually doing something at all. But these effects will not actually occur until decades from now, many of them. When you project forward our current progress, which is the bottom dotted lines there, compared to where we're trying to get to, which is up here and here, you'll see that we're going to fall well short. And so I think this is why I've said in the title, we're failing. UNESCO noticed this as well, obviously, that we're not going to reach any of the targets for water quality by 2025. In fact, we won't, at the current activity level, we won't meet them for far, far longer than that. And with the rate of climate change as it at the moment, they'll be far too late. Far too late. So we've spent a lot of money. So that's important. We have spent, this is not trivial money, $500-700 million. We're only making minor progress, though. We have numbers that have been developed in government reports for how much money it would really require to get to those targets we talked about, $10 billion. You may have seen that number around. It's a rather crude number, but it's an indication of the real money needed. We've only got a tenth of that over the next few years. And current federal government lack of action, I don't think we're going to have... I'm talking about hope here, aren't we? I'll give you some better hope in a minute, maybe. We're not going to have adequate water quality management with the current regime. And then there's climate change we won't talk about. We do know what would work, though. We think we know from published material what worked in other places in the world and what could work here. We need money. We need the proper money to do this properly. And it's quite sad. We're spending a lot of money. This is not trivial money, as I said, we are spending, but it's not enough to have an appreciable effect. we need to implement the legislation that's available to us to manage water quality, federal legislation. And these are old pieces of legislation. They can be used tomorrow. The Great Barrier Reef Marine Park Act of 1975, EPBC, the main Commonwealth Environment legislation of 1989, and the third one's the Queensland legislation about managing water quality that is being implemented at the moment. But the first two aren't. The Marine Park Act, people think, can we regulate farmers using the Marine Park Act? Absolutely. It's called 66.2E, and it says you can manage things from outside the park if they're impacting on the park. This is no legal barrier to using this. There'd be lots of political barriers to using it. There are no legal barriers to using it. And EPBC says the same thing. It refers to the World Heritage Area this time, not the Marine Park, slight difference, but you can take action of things outside the bounds of the World Heritage Area that are impacting on the World Heritage Area. And the Queensland legislation's there too, but it is being implemented, but Queensland, with its present balance in the parliament, it's sort of hard for them to do too much. So there is a way forward for banishment. I'm not going to go through all these points, but some of the other interesting things, we should be looking at the whole of the Great Barrier Reef, including Torres Strait, Harvey Bay, and maybe the Coral Sea Reefs as well as a management area rather than just the World Heritage Area. We need a proper plan of how to spend the money. We don't have that at the moment. We do need to use these existing legislative routes to management, and we need to fund it properly. There is another problem, the last one. There are plans to develop agriculture and expand agriculture in the Great Barrier Reef catchment. We have to look at that pretty carefully. And this just repeats some of those things. We need a radically shifted management regime than we have now. We use those federal legislation. And as I said at the beginning, I think we need now to refocus our management, given that we're not going to be able to restore the Great Barrier Reef. Where can we spend this water quality money to preserve the bits we want or the processes we want, since we can't do it all? And that's really important in light of what's going on at the moment and what Terry talked about. We have to refocus our aims to a lower level, unfortunately, but a realistic level. Thank you.